Good morning, and welcome to Winfield United Methodist Church. I'm Reverend Betsy Singleton Snyder, Senior Pastor, and we are so glad that you are here worshiping with us this morning. We are available now online at our website, winfieldumc.com, as well as on Facebook at Winfield UMC. And we really encourage you, especially if you're a member, to share this particular post of our service and have a watch party and let other people know that we are available for worship. You can also register your attendance, whether you're a member or guest, on our website so that we'll know that you are watching. And if I can do anything for you or our church family, we would be so glad to reach out to you. You can leave your email at that safe and secure location. I would just lift up a couple of things that we have going on right now on Sunday evenings. Tonight it's sunset yoga and prayer at 7:30 in our back parking lot. An hour of relaxation and yoga and prayer. We welcome anyone who would like to come. It's very safe and it's outside. We are also now collecting diapers for a diaper drive. And I got my first box from someone this week. So we'll be storing those and let you know more about that in our collection. But if you're interested, go on Amazon.com or your favorite retailer, pick those up, or even send them to our address at 20-100 Cantrell Road. You can look that up on our website, but we would be so grateful. Will you join with me in prayer? Gracious God, be with us this morning as we worship you and give you all the praise, honor, and glory. In the name of Christ, amen. As we prepare to sing, we invite you at home to join with us. You can stand if you're able and sing along with us.
Mm-hmm. Good morning. My name is Debbie Hulsey, and I am here to share our children's moment. Our story today is about a young boy named Joseph. Joseph's father had made him a coat of many colors, and it was very beautiful. Joseph had 11 brothers. Can you imagine? Joseph's brothers were jealous, though, because it seemed that their father maybe loved Joseph a little bit more than them, and that maybe he loved them best, or loved him best. This made his brothers angry. His brothers were so jealous that they even wanted to harm him. Joseph was only 17 years old. Bible stories are given to us to help us learn about lessons about life and how to live a good life. I'm going to stop the story here so that we can talk a little bit about the lesson of this story. I think the lesson might be about jealousy. Do you know what it feels like to be jealous? Jealousy makes you want something that belongs to another person. Maybe you believe that you're not being treated as well as that other person or unfairly, that someone maybe is being given more than you have. The secret about jealousy is that people who feel jealous, they don't feel good about themselves. Jealousy makes a person feel angry. No good can come from that. Let me explain jealousy this way. Picture a mean, angry green dragon, maybe about this color. This dragon stays in his cave all the time, and he just gets more and more angry. Well, no good can come from that. Jealousy is like that angry, mean dragon. To feel jealous of another person is to feel like you're stuck in a cave full of anger, and that does not sound like a good place to be. Don't let this happen to your good life. Learn to tame that jealous dragon. Joseph's brothers treated him very badly, and he was sent away. He was eventually sold to get Joseph out of their hair. Learn to tame that jealous dragon. Do you know that in the end, Joseph forgave his brothers, and they had a wonderful life? Jealousy keeps you stuck in anger, but forgiveness sets you free. Would you say a prayer with me? Lord, you are so powerful that you can take away the bad things and turn them into good things. We pray that you'll help us look for how you want to turn things around when something bad happens in our lives. Amen.
Almighty and everlasting God, who sustains all life and offers us hope, I come to you this morning with the prayers of the people of Winfield. We pray first that your Holy Spirit will inspire our hearts, our minds, and our bodies to be the people that you intend us to be. And we thank you for such examples of John Robert Lewis, who so faithfully carried out his witness throughout his life. We mourn his death, but we celebrate his life. In this time of pandemic, help us to be unselfishly willing to wear our masks so that others might be safe from us, as we might carry a virus that we don't know about. While we know of no one in our own community who has tested positive for the coronavirus, we pray for those of our number who are currently quarantined. We pray for the people of Mississippi who've been so very hard hit with the coronavirus. We grieve with Mark and Linda Olent in the loss of Mark's father, Robert. We grieve in the health problems of some of our number. We ask that you be with those who've been quarantined. Father, we think of those in Beirut who have been so devastated. And we ask that you be with the workers who relieve them. We ask all these things in the name of him who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Sometimes we find ourselves being a little bit stubborn about letting God take care of what we know he can take care of. We want to take care of it ourselves. But we don't have that power. But we do have the power to let our pride down and let God break through. And that's what we are going to sing about this morning. So if you will stand, if you're able, and sing with us this prayer for God to break through our darkness.
Break through all my doubts. Break through all our fears. Break through that I may worship you. Thank you.
The scripture reading for today is Genesis 37, verses 1 through 4, and verses 14 through 28. Please stand as you are able for the reading. Jacob lived in the land of Canaan, where his father was an immigrant. This is the account of Jacob's descendants. Joseph was 17 years old and tended the flock with his brothers. While he was helping the sons of Bilhah and Zilpah, his father's wives, Joseph told their father unflattering things about them. Now Israel loved Joseph more than any of his other sons because he was born when Jacob was old. Jacob had made for him a long robe. When his brothers saw that their father loved him more than any of his brothers, they hated him and couldn't even talk nicely to him. Jacob said to him, "Go, find out how your brothers are and how the flock is, and report back to me." So Jacob sent him from the Hebron Valley, and when he approached Shechem, a man found him wandering in the fields and asked him, "What are you looking for?" Joseph said, "I'm looking for my brothers. Tell me, where are they? Where are they tending the sheep?" The man said, "They left here. I heard them saying, 'Let's go to Dothan.'" So Joseph went after his brothers and found them in Dothan. They saw Joseph in the distance before he got close to them, and they plotted to kill him. The brothers said to each other, "Here comes the big dreamer. Come on now, let's kill him and throw him into one of the cisterns, and we'll say a wild animal devoured him. Then we will see what becomes of his dreams." When Reuben heard what they said, he saved him from them, telling them, "Let's not take his life." Reuben said to them, "Don't spill his blood. Throw him instead into this desert cistern, but don't lay a hand on him." He intended to save Joseph from them and take him back to his father. When Joseph reached his brothers, they stripped off Joseph's long robe, took him and threw him into the cistern, an empty cistern with no water in it. When they sat down to eat, they looked up and saw a caravan of Ishmaelites coming from Gilead with camels carrying sweet resin, medicinal resin, and fragrant resin on their way down to Egypt. Judah said to his brothers, "What do we gain if we kill our brother and hide his blood? Come on, let's sell him to the Ishmaelites. Let's not harm him because he is our brother. He's family." His brothers agreed. When some Midianite traders passed by, they pulled Joseph up out of the cistern. They sold him to the Ishmaelites for 20 pieces of silver, and they brought Joseph to Egypt. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
You may be seated. Join with me in a spirit of prayer. Gracious God, either through me or in spite of me, speak the good news that we may all hear it, embrace it, and above all, live it. In the name of Jesus the Christ, the risen one, amen. Our immediate family consists of me, my husband Victor, and our four boys. When they were tiny infants, I could never have imagined them a huge teen and three preteens arguing and fighting. Back in the good old days, when they were really little, they hugged on each other, they played well for hours, and they were just a really sweet tribe. The difficulties of sibling rivalry are not lost on anyone who has had at least one or more brothers and sisters. It often seems to me the larger the family, the harder to maneuver all the feelings, particularly big, hurtful ones like resentment, envy, bitterness, and jealousy. The story of Israel's younger son, Joseph, which Carol just read is a classic tale of rivalry and a family that descends into betrayal. For those of us who grew up hearing this biblical story, we may have been taught mostly to understand that the stories told about Joseph through Genesis are about a hero and a favorite son. If we didn't read it carefully, we might have missed the details about how young Joseph is not only the favorite because he was born when his father was old, but he is also, my friends, a tattletale and a gossip, and he's very self-important. He tends to tell his family about his dreams of grandeur, how they will eventually all bow down to him. Even though he is his father's favorite, Israel nonetheless scolds him for repeating such grandiose dreams in front of him and his mother and his brothers. Seems everyone knows Joseph is full of himself. When Joseph's father sends him off to locate his shepherding brothers, we can see how absolutely annoying they find him. As he approaches them at work, they say, "Oh, here comes the big dreamer. Come on now, let's kill him and throw him in one of the wells." And then we'll say a wild animal devoured him. Then we'll see what becomes of his dreams. Bitterness, resentment, jealousy, and hatred. Joseph, you see, faces a mob of his own brothers. They're talking of killing him. Only Reuben, who is already in trouble, mind you, with his father for breaking clan protocol with one of Israel's concubines, that's a no-no. Reuben suggests, "No, let's not spill any blood over this." Of course, Reuben intends to save Joseph, only to get back in the good graces of his father. But even Reuben's suggestion, as an older one in the family, cannot stop the brother's anger and resentment. The brothers strip Joseph of his handmade coat and they throw him in an empty well. At the urging of another brother, Judah, they decide to sell him off then to a caravan of passing Ishmaelite traders. They'll take him to Egypt. They'll sell him off. But the brothers will go home and they will tell their father that he was devoured by a wild animal. My friends, this story is not new. It is all around us. One author notes that resentment seems to be multiplying and gaining a foothold worldwide, beyond families. A search on the internet of the word resentment leads to the culmination of a particular condition, a condition called hatred. John Snyder, a pastor and author, writes that resentment can harm or delude you without your even knowing it. It clouds your reasoning. It keeps you from recognizing the truth and makes you incapable of seeing someone else's point of view. It gives us a false sense of power for a while. Yet when the adrenaline rush is gone, the self-doubt, the shame, the loss of self-control floods back. Carrie Fisher, the late actress and author, put it this way: resentment is like drinking poison and waiting for the other person to die. Joseph's brother's resentment leads to an action that is horrific, almost deadly. This shouldn't surprise us. Remember that resentment can be dangerous. We hear of news stories where people store up years and years of resentment, and then one day they harm other people. We've seen it in our schools where shootings have taken place. We saw it only a year ago. There was a year anniversary last week. It was of the Walmart in El Paso where a man shot 23 people dead, and authorities determined it to be an act of domestic terror, maybe even a hate crime. We saw it in Georgia in February, when two white men literally hunted down and shot a black man jogging, a young black man jogging in his neighborhood, and their friend videoed it, even the part where the shooter used a racial slur over Ahmaud Arbery's dying body. Remember, too, my dear Christian friends, remember, too, that resentment about the content of Jesus' teachings and actions are one reason he ended up also on a Roman cross. Small and long-held resentment still hurts, whether it happens in families or other kinds of communities, including churches. Churches can become resentful. Resentment can choke the life out of a person or out of a faith community. I'll never forget listening to a layperson years ago who could not quit talking about one pastor that she could not stand. Now, it had been at least 15 or 20 years since he'd served that particular church, but she was still talking about him rather than the mission of God's church and its future. We can see how resentment happens among humans, but how is it and why is it that we come to resent God our Father? If God is all loving, all forgiving, all merciful, and all just, then why do people come to resent God? Counselors, as well as pastors and confidants, hear a lot of reasons. I'm going to give you a few of the reasons that I've heard over time. I don't feel in control. My illness is getting worse, even though I ask God to help me. I don't know who God is. I prayed fervently, but I still got a divorce. My loved one died, even though I pleaded with God. Life's stresses overwhelm. I beg God to get us out of bankruptcy. I'm getting older and feeling more powerless. I struggle with discouragement and depression. God doesn't hear me. I've experienced mistreatment and abuse, awful abuse, by other people. In the midst of this pandemic, illness and death, job losses, more hunger now, and homelessness are being seen all over the news. I suspect more people are wondering, where is God in all of this? Especially, my friends, those who have misunderstood the nature of God. In other words, what God is like and who God is. Let me offer an example of that misunderstanding. My husband was reading the paper, or now we read the iPad, the other day, and he came across an article about the maddening reasons people won't wear masks. He called me in the other room just to share one of the quotes. This is from a 21-year-old woman I'm going to call Victoria. "We're kind of over this whole COVID thing. I won't wear a mask unless I absolutely have to." She added, "I am a very strong Christian. And I know where I'm going, and I believe God will take me when I'm supposed to go. If I get COVID and I die from COVID, it's not my decision." Is Victoria saying that God will decide if she dies of COVID? Or perhaps Victoria is trying to say that God is in complete control and Victoria has no power at all, or none? Or is she saying that God will allow her death no matter her actions? And what of Victoria's Christian ethics? Is she, as a Christian, not responsible for her neighbor who needs protection from this illness because he might die if he contracts it? If I were not a thinking Christian, friends, Victoria would probably lead me to resent God too. In an essay about God's power, Debbie Thomas writes that thinking like Victoria's leads us to conclude, maybe God allowed the hurricane in order to demonstrate divine power over nature. Maybe God allowed the neck injury in order to build character. Maybe God allowed the bomb to detonate in order to punish sin. If that is our conclusion about God in the midst of trials and hardships, then no wonder we come to resent God. To explain why some Christians get caught up in this misguided view of God's nature, there is a prevalent teaching, and it's been around a long time. It It's been around since the beginning of Christianity, and it's called divine determinism. Divine determinism. And it emphasizes the sovereignty of God in a way that believes God designs, ordains, and governs whatever happens without exception. In its extreme, this claim about God comes close to suggesting then that God is the author of sin and evil as well as suffering. Think about that. The 16th century Protestant reformer John Calvin was an everything happens for a reason theologian. He struggled to make a coherent case for his notion of predestination, which suggests that God wills everything for a good purpose but allows evil. Now, no offense toward Calvin, but he was not a Methodist. In fact, the Reverend John Wesley, the founder of Methodism, wrote an essay viciously attacking, I find this title hysterical, viciously attacking divine determinism, and his essay was entitled Predestination Calmly Considered. Wesley's passion come through. Wesley could never accept that God would decide ahead which people were damned regardless of their decisions to reject or accept God's grace. No. Another problem, too, with this view of divine determinism is that it assumes little, if any, you see, human free will. Free will. Our friend Victoria, the young woman, she says she believes that she has no free will. And yet she chooses not to wear a mask and blame God for what might happen. That means she is denying that God created humans like us who have the free will to choose good over evil. We're free to love over hate. Victoria, though, would have us to believe that she is a puppet, that we are puppets. My friends, God didn't create puppets. Where God pulls all the strings. We're free. It's a free creation. And we must also remember that God does not make other gods. What do I mean? What God makes, what God creates, is heaven and earth and all creation. And everything in it is finite, limited. You and I are going to die. It doesn't go on forever. God doesn't make another God that lasts forever. Remember the words of the prophet Isaiah? The grass withers, the flower fades, but the word of our God will stand forever. This creation is not the same thing as the Creator. If we think carefully about the freedom and finiteness of God's creation, it is the height of arrogance to believe that nothing bad or hard will ever happen to us. When I am tempted to resent God when difficult circumstances arise in my life, when I've been in the pit, or maybe even put in the pit, like Joseph, either ones that I helped to create or ones that others did that hurt me, I find that I am called to look more carefully at my life. My actions. What of those people too, whom God has sent to me to comfort me, to challenge me, to pick me up and get me headed in a better direction? What of those who have extended grace and hospitality in my life, in your life, I suspect? When we find ourselves resenting God for this pandemic or for the ignorance of others, I try to look for those who model presence and love, God's love, caregivers on duty, medical professionals. And the other night as I sat in my home, I watched these incredible teachers and administrators trying to provide school for our kids on a Zoom call. On a Zoom call, I saw these dedicated professionals, loving people whose strength, it's not like Iron Man, or Wonder Woman, but they are pouring themselves out for children in a situation of vulnerability and uncertainty, even themselves. And I felt such love and care right there in a painful and hard, scary situation. When we find ourselves resenting God, let us remember that God walked with our imperfect ancestors, like Joseph and his family. And then, one day, God chose to enter this world. The God of the universe came to us, my friends, as a baby, red-faced, crying, helpless, who grew up and fed the hungry and healed the sick and welcomed children and washed feet and died on a cross. God the invincible, my friends, is really almighty power that lays down its life for love. That's the kind of love that I can't resent and I can't resist. Thanks be to God. Amen. My friends, as I said earlier in the service, the Church of Jesus is not closed. We are still open, and we do need your gifts to continue our ministries, especially those of you who are our members and dedicated to this site and mission launch pad called Winfield United Methodist Church. You can give online through our website by going to an automatic draft document and make that possible to be deducted from your account each week, or put it with your bill pay list, and we're working on an online option. But remember that there are so many ways to serve, so I invite you to consider serving as well as giving wherever you can and however you are able in your situation. We also are accepting people to join our church at this time, one family, one person at a time. So if you're looking for a family of faith, please be in touch with us. Let us pray. Gracious God, we ask that you help us and guide us in sharing all that we have, because everything we have is from you. We are the stewards. We are the stewards of this creation and all that is in it. Help us to give in ways of abundance that will be helpful, that will save lives and recreate the future. In the name of Christ, amen. comes to unite with our church. She is a United Methodist, and so will be coming by transfer. But I ask you, Brenda, these questions. As a member of Winfield United Methodist Church, will you faithfully serve Jesus Christ and participate in its ministries by your prayers, your presence, your gifts, your service, and your witness? And we have a response to make as well to Brenda. Will you join with me? As members of Winfield United Methodist Church, we renew our vows to faithfully participate by our prayers, our presence, our gifts, our service, and our witness. May God be glorified. One of the things I want to tell you about Brenda is that she loves dogs, and she's married to a sweet man named Vince, whom I did their wedding, so I've known them a while. But Brenda is a dog trainer, and this is her rescue dog, Rodney. She has other creatures, other dogs too, but this is a special story. It took her over 6 weeks to rescue him while he was out running loose. And so it's a tale of love. It kind of reminds me of the way God chases after us in love. You're an image of God and God's grace in all that you do. She's rescued and helped so much. She's going to help with our pet ministry, and I'm real excited about that. So welcome, Brenda, and online, would you respond and let her know how grateful we are that you are here. Receive this blessing, brothers and sisters. Go forth and love God and your neighbor in all that you do. Bear witness to the love of Jesus Christ so that those who do not know that love will find in each and every one of us most treasured and generous friends. In the name of Christ, amen.